जी राजेंद्र पवार द फाउंडर ऑफ NIIT मेंबर्स ऑफ द फैकल्टी एंड द गवर्निंग बॉडी एंड पेरेंट्स ऑफ स्टूडेंट्स एंड वेल विशर्स एंड सपोर्टर्स एंड रिलेटिव्स एंड ओल्ड फ्रेंड्स इन द ऑडियंस गेटिंग ओल्डर एवरी डे इट इज रियली अ ग्रेट प्लेजर टू कम बैक अ ईयर लेटर एंड टू सी दैट दिस आइडिया of NIIT, which is a unique experiment, because normally when universities are built, you put up a building and then you fill it, and then you put up the second building when you get the money and then you fill it. This is planned ab initio as an integrated, holistic, environment friendly university, and I am very impressed. I have seen last time I went around, I was explained how the university has been planned. And it's only the beginning, it's only the second year really of students, and you will have to look for the next 10 years at least. But I am confident that the NIIT will develop as a very major center for holistic learning, not only for MBAs and BTECs and MTECs, but for holistic learning, which develops the totality of our personality. Now, I was originally going to talk to you today about, last time I talked about four pillars of learning. And I was going to speak to you today about five dimensions of management. But I'm using my chairperson's prerogative not to make that speech. I'll make that for next year if you still want me. Because I'd rather, after Gurucharan has already given a full lecture, I make a few comments on the Mahabharata and then come down to the question of the holistic personality. Mahabharata is a terrible book. Hum to apne ghar mein bhi nahi rakhte hain Mahabharata. Ladai ho jati. I am deeply opposed to the Mahabharata, particularly because my name is Karna. And I have grown up with an animus against the Pandavas, and if I may say so, against the master manipulator behind the Mahabharata, Thakurji himself. Because all the adharmic acts that took place, Bhishma was killed by fraud, Duryodhana, Dronacharya was killed by fraud, Jayadrath was killed by fraud, and Duryodhana was killed by fraud, and Karna was killed by fraud. Not a single one of these warriors were killed in fair fight. And we talk of dharma. Where is the dharma? And if Shri Krishna had really wanted to prevent the fight, he had to do only one thing. In the middle of the darbar, he had to get up, instead of waiting until the last day and telling Karna so that they break his will to fight, which is an act of cruelty, he could have got up in the sabha and said, I have an announcement to make. And the announcement is, Karna is the eldest Pandava. Kunti would have got up and accepted it. Karna would have been accepted both by Yudhishthira and Duryodhana. There would have been no battle. But Sri Krishna was determined to exterminate both the Kauravas and his own Yadavas. Because don't forget, at the end of the war, when Gandhari cursed him and said that in the same way as you have destroyed the Kauravas, your Vamsha will also be destroyed. And you yourself will die forgotten and alone in a jungle, in the way you killed my son also by fraud. So I have very mixed and ambiguous feelings about the Mahabharata. I'm sorry, I had to get it off my chest, because I couldn't sit down and swallow all these things about the Mahabharata. I have lots of other questions. I'm not going to go into those at the moment. However, I think that Gurucharan's exposition is really a very, very interesting one, particularly about the way he himself broadened his consciousness by going from subject to subject, from area to area. I think that is tremendously important. What he told us about his student days. And that explains how now he's got this synoptic vision and is able to look at problems from a much broader point of view. And that, I hope, is what the students of NIIT will do. You will specialize in certain subjects, certainly, but never close your mind, never keep your mind closed only to one area, but strengthen it and broaden it. Because that, to my mind, is what will be required in the global age into which we are now hurtling. Because yesterday Lord Desai gave a lecture on the Maulana Azad Memorial Lecture on Indian thought and globalization. And that the point was made there, that the fact that we have such a strong pluralistic tradition in India, even in Hinduism itself, it's a pluralistic thing. And also, it is a dialogic civilization, remember that. The Upanishads are dialogues. And they, to my mind, I'm sure Gurcharan will agree, they are the great books of the West. I mean, the greatest books of the West are the Upanishads. Even the Gita is a derivative text. Now, in the Upanishads and in the Gita, the whole wisdom arises from questions. Every Upanishad starts with a question. Why are we here? Kasminnu bhago vijyate sarvamidam vijyatam bhavati. What is that by knowing which everything becomes known? How is it that we are here? Who impels us to be here? It's a question and an answer. The Gita is also the same. Karpanya dosho pahat svabhava prichhamitva dharma sammoodha cheta yat shrehasyat nishchitam ruhitanme shishyasteham shadimam tvam prapannam. From this first question of Arjuna, who wants to be taught what dharma is by Sri Krishna, the whole Gita flows. So ours is a dialogic, there is a difference between a dialogic civilization and a revealed civilization. In a revealed civilization, you have a revelation. You have a person or a book or a revelation which is there. You can't question the person who gave that revelation. Why did you say this? What does this mean? You can, perhaps there is some scope for some interpretation, but basically the revelation is there. You've got to either live with it or reject it. I'm not making a value judgment, I'm just making a point. But in the Indic tradition, whether it is Hinduism, Jainism, Buddhism, is based entirely on questions. The Buddha was asked questions for 60 years for the whole of his life, till the end of his life. Every day his disciples were asking him questions. Mahavira was being asked questions. So therefore, the dialogic nature of Indian civilization, I think, makes us particularly well suited for the global society. Because in the global society now, you can no longer stick to one rigid formulation. Because by definition, you are dealing with a wide spectrum of ideas, of backgrounds, and of thoughts. So I would like to say that as we move into the global society, we need young men and women with holistic personalities. And as I see it, there are several dimensions of this holism which have got to be grasped by the students. And the first, of course, the first aspect of all education is the body. Sharira madhyam khalu dharma sadhana. All dharma is based upon the body. So this business of treating the body as if it was something undesirable, or fasting it to death, or poisoning it through alcohol or tobacco or drugs or unsafe sex, that is, you're ruining yourselves. The body is the temple of the divine. The body is a unique entity. The human body, which includes the mind and all other elements, is a unique entity. It is the most highly evolved entity on this planet. That is why in our tradition, human birth is considered to be so rare and so much to be prized. And it is curious how, it is strange and sad how people neglect the body, misuse the body, and don't realize that keeping the body fit and strong and well is the only way in which you can progress. So my first advice to young people is, look after your body. Whether you do it through yoga, you do it through Tai Chi, you do it through PT as we used to do as children, or you do it in any other way, in a gym, you do it through yoga. You don't need an expensive gymnasium to keep your body fit. You can do it perfectly well by yoga. You don't even need your clothes for the yoga. So this idea that no, we must have 3 crores of rupees chahiye ji hame gymnasium ke liye. But gymnasium kya karne apne kamre mein baith ke ya bahar baith ke apne shareer ko banao. So we are now becoming dependent even for our physical development upon technology. So you know, these are all distortions. It's become a big thing now. I'm going to the gym in the morning, you know, I'm going to go to the gym in the evening. Okay, fair enough, you want to go to the gym, go to the gym, I have nothing against it. If you can pay 10,000 bucks a month just to get onto one of those weird torture machines, you're welcome to do so. But I think that they're not absolutely necessary. There are many ways of keeping fit. And as I said, don't poison your bodies, eat well, don't get stuck on junk food. Therefore, the first element of this holistic person, the holistic NIIT graduate, must be a strong, supple and powerful body. Swami Vivekananda said that we need young people with muscles of iron and nerves of steel. That's very strongly put. I don't think all the girls should have muscles of iron and nerves of steel. That makes them, but they have to be equally strong. In fact, the woman's body in some ways is genetically stronger than that of the man. And even in our Commonwealth Games, I think the women this time really did better than the men. And that proves something. In any case, women are ruling India. The five most important people in India are women. We have a woman president, we have a woman speaker of the Lok Sabha, we have a woman president of the National Congress, we have a woman leader of the opposition, we have a woman chief minister of the biggest state in India. What more can anyone ask for? So we are already living apparently in a matriarchal society. So you better get used to that. But the boys had better perk up, otherwise you're going to be sort of overcome. Okay, so the first element is the body. Second element is the mind. The mind also, remember, in the same way as the body needs to be trained, the mind also needs to be trained. It is a mistake to think, okay, the mind to chalega jaise chalega, then you'll spend your life in discursive thinking, in scattered thoughts. And that is what meditation does, that is what yoga does, that is what prayer does. It teaches you to concentrate the energies of the mind. And the energies of the mind, like a torch, you know, those torches, if you put it in one direction, the light gets all diffused. But if you turn it around, gradually it comes into focus and becomes sharp. That is what you have to do with your minds. Ask questions. As I said, ours is a dialogic civilization. Get good ideas. Aro bhadra kritavo vantu vishvatha. Get noble thoughts. Let us get noble thoughts from anywhere, wherever they come from. That has been India's genius. We've been on the crossroads of civilization. We've absorbed great ideas. We've given great ideas to the world. And therefore, your minds must also be supple. Respect your elders. But don't necessarily believe or accept everything they say. You've got to make up your own minds. I think Indian parents tend to be too possessive. As Khalil Gibran says, your children may come through you, but they don't belong to you. Each young person comes with his own or her own karma, and their own genetic predisposition, if you like. And therefore, the importance of a supple and subtle mind, a capacity to ask questions, a capacity to get to the heart of the problem rather than get sidetracked on the way. These are all things that you have to develop while you are at university. So you first of all have your body, strong, supple, well maintained. Then you have your mind, clear and concentrated. Then you've got to develop your emotions. People generally don't speak about emotions in university. You're not supposed to speak about emotions. But emotions are of the essence of our personality. In fact, if you look upon the body as the body of the plane, then the two engines are the mind and the emotions. If your emotions are not under control, if you are, as Guru Charan has said, if you are seized with envy and greed and hatred, that's as destructive as tuberculosis, AIDS or cholera. And physically also now the psychosomatic linkages are being proved. So that if you want to have a healthy life, you have to have a mind also, you have to have a heart also that is able to integrate the emotions. Everybody goes through emotional problems. Everybody goes through disappointments and ups and downs. But you have to learn to live with them. You mustn't be swept away by whatever wave comes in your life. You have to learn to live with your emotions. You have to learn to allow it to come to terms with your emotions. Don't try and suppress them, because then you are distorting your personalities. So you've got to come to terms with your emotions, and yet you've got to see that they are integrated with the rest of your life. Then so that is another element. You have the bodies, you have the mind, you have the emotions, and then what you have to learn, particularly in this age, is the capacity for teamwork, the capacity to live together. Because no longer are we simply only individuals, we are also part of society. And that is one area where in India we have traditionally been weak. Because we've had great heroes, great individuals, great archers. Arjuna and Karna. Karna was the greatest archer, by the way. Arjuna was only known as the greatest archer, but Karna was the one who was really greater than him and had to be shot when his chariot was dhvast in the ground. I'll never forget that. Never forgive that. But you've got to work together. You see, we have great individuals. We have produced yodhas, we have produced individual Vishwanathan and chess players. But when it comes to teamwork, we have been weak so far. Now we are beginning gradually. And I think one of the most hopeful things that has happened recently is when those girls won the relay, four into whatever it is, 100 meters or whatever relay. Because that was a teamwork, they had to do it. You see, you've got to work together. Sahana vavatu, sahana bhuraktu, sahiviryam karvavahe, tejasvinavadhitavastu mahavidvishah. May we work together, may we achieve together, may we think together. Mahavidvishavahe, may there be no hatred between us. Now this is important. The Indian tradition, we have to develop this tradition of teamwork. How did the Japanese do the miracle? How did the Germans do the miracle? After the end of the war, as you know, there wasn't a single house standing anywhere in Berlin or anywhere in Germany. Japan was devastated. And yet within 20 years, those countries built themselves up. Not because they had great geniuses, but because they had this capacity for dedicated and hard teamwork. And that teamwork is something I think you will have to learn also. Because howsoever brilliant you may be on your own, unless you have the capacity to work with other people, you will not be able to achieve a truly holistic personality. Sri Rama we look upon as an avatar. But even he, when he had to go to Sri Lanka to rescue Sita, he had to first of all train an army. He had to get all those thousands of Vanaras to join him. And then he had to, then he made his attack on Sri Lanka. And thousands of people were killed, and then he was able to retrieve Sita. So he could have said, you could have said, ke bhai, just one bow and do it, you're an avatar. Or Sri Krishna could have done his Sudarshan Chakra and finished the whole thing. But no, teamwork is there. And that is something you will have to learn to work. You'll have to learn to work with people whom you may not like. In politics, one is constantly working with people one does not like. But nonetheless, you've got to learn to work with people. So, and then the fifth element, I've talked about the physical, the intellectual, the emotional, the social, as it were, the teamwork, and finally the spiritual. That is the inner core of our personality. The inner core of our personality has got to revolve around the light that is within. Ishvara sarva bhutanam hriddeshe tishtati. The Lord resides in the heart of all beings. The Upanishad tells us, Hiranamaye pare koshe virjam brahma nishkalam tat shubram jyotisham jyotis tatatatma vidho vidho. In the deepest golden sheath resides the luminous Atman. That is what the knowers of the Atman know. We believe that that light that permeates this entire universe also is within us. Ultimately, Ishavasya Medam Sarvam Yatkin Jagatyam Jagat. The entire universe is permeated by that light. And that light is within us. The Christians call it the light that lighteth every man that cometh into the world. The Sikhs say, Noor the Sab Jagga. The Sufis call it the Noor-e-Ilahi. In that marvelous poem, it is described not where the wheeling systems darken and our benumbed conceiving soars, the drift of pinions would we hearken, beats at our own clay shuttered doors. The angels keep their ancient places, turn but a stone and start a wing. Tis ye, tis your estranged faces that miss the many splendored thing. The many splendored light of the Atma, the glory of human consciousness, the fact that we are here living, alive creatures, thinking creatures on this planet where there are billions and billions of galaxies. We must remember that always. And that inner light is there around which our personalities must develop. We live in an age of multiple identities. But if those identities are centered around a strong center, then it doesn't matter how many concentric circles you have, you'll be there. But if you don't have a center and your center shifts with each identity, then you become eccentric, then you become neurotic, and then you become a menace instead of becoming a positive factor in human affairs. So find that light within you, develop your bodies, develop your minds, develop your emotions, develop your capacities to work with others, and finally look within. That is why you have this opportunity when you look at the sunrise and the sunset. That's, I think, an extraordinary innovation by Raji. Getting young people to watch. Aaj to hai bhi chhat. Aaj to surya ki puja karte hain. It's a very auspicious day. Dheya sada savitri bandala madhyavarti narayana sarasija sarasannibishta keyur van makara kundala van kiriti hari hiranyame vapu dhitashanka chakra avahayatam divijam dinesham saptashvabaham dhivinim grihesham sindhura varana pratibhava bhasam bhajami suryam kulavriddhi heto. So you watch the sunrise, you watch the sunset, see the beauty of nature around you. Learn to see beauty in a grain of sand, eternity in a grain of sand, and beauty in a flower. Then and then only will you become holistic people, and then only will you fulfill the promise and the potentiality of NIIT. Thank you.